This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action JCPOA Persian, Translate. Monitor and verify Iran's compliance with the agreement. The International Atomic Energy Agency IAEA will have regular access to all Iranian nuclear facilities. The agreement provides that in return for verifiably abiding by its commitments, Iran will receive relief from US, European Union, and United Nations Security Council nuclear-related economic sanctions. Contents 1. Background 2. Negotiations 21. Signatories 3. Summary of provisions 31. Nuclear 32. Sanctions 4. Records 5. Reactions 51. Political and diplomatic reactions 511 from countries that are parties to the JCPOA, 512 from other countries, 513 from international organizations, 52 expert reactions, 53 in popular culture, 54 public opinion surveys, 541 United States nationwide, 542 United States specific communities, 543 Iran, 544 Germany, 6 process, 61 incorporated into international law by the United Nations Security Council, 62 approved by European Union, 63 review period in the United States Congress, 631 Obama administration, 632 public debate, 633 Congressional Committee Hearings, 634 Congressional Support and Opposition, 635 Congressional Votes, 64 Review Period in Iran, 65 Adoption Day, 66 Implementation Day, 7 Deterring Iran from Obtaining Nuclear Weapons, 8 Aftermath, 81 Impact, 811 Economic, 812 Scientific, 813 Diplomatic, 82 Continued Tensions, 83 Iran-US Prisoner Exchange, 84 Continued Criticism, 85 Violations, 9 See also 10 Notes, 11 References, 12 External Links. Background see also, Nuclear Program of Iran and Nuclear Proliferation. A nuclear weapon uses a fissile material to cause a nuclear chain reaction. The most commonly used materials have been uranium-235, U-235 and plutonium-239, P-239. Both uranium-233, U-233 and reactor-grade plutonium have also been used. The amount of uranium or plutonium needed depends on the sophistication of the design, with a simple design requiring approximately 15. The wake of the revolution, Ayatollah Ruhollah Khomeini was initially opposed to nuclear technology, and Iran engaged in a costly war with Iraq from 1980 to 1988. Starting in the later 1980s, Iran restarted its nuclear program, with assistance from Pakistan, which entered into a bilateral agreement with Iran in 1992, China, which did the same in 1990, and Russia, which did the same in 1992 and 1995, and from the AQ Khan network. Iran began pursuing an indigenous nuclear fuel cycle capability by developing a uranium mining infrastructure and experimenting with uranium conversion and enrichment. According to the Nonpartisan Nuclear Threat Initiative, U.S. intelligence agencies have long suspected Iran of using its civilian nuclear program as a cover for clandestine weapons development. Iran, in contrast, has always insisted that its nuclear work is peaceful. In August 2002, the Paris-based National Council of Resistance of Iran, an Iranian dissident group, publicly revealed the existence of two undeclared nuclear facilities, the Iraq Heavy Water Production Facility and the Natanz Enrichment Facility, in February 2003. Iranian President Mohammad Khatami acknowledged the existence of the facilities and asserted that Iran had undertaken small-scale enrichment experiments to produce low-enriched uranium for nuclear power plants in late February. International Atomic Energy Agency IAEA inspectors visited Natanz in May 2003. Iran allowed IAEA inspectors to visit the Kalei Electric Company, but refused to allow them to take samples, and an IAEA report the following month concluded that Iran had failed to meet its obligations under the previous agreement in June 2003. Iran, faced with the prospect of being referred to the UN Security Council, entered into diplomatic negotiations with France, Germany, and the United Kingdom, the EU. The United States refused to be involved in these negotiations in October 2003. The Tehran Declaration was reached between Iran and the EU. Under this declaration, Iran agreed to cooperate fully with the IAEA, sign the additional protocol, Protocol, and temporarily suspend all uranium enrichment in September and October 2003. The IAEA conducted several facility inspections. This was followed by the Paris Agreement in November 2004, in which Iran agreed to temporarily suspend enrichment and conversion activities, including the manufacture, installation, testing, and operation of centrifuges, and committed to working with the EU3 to find a mutually beneficial long-term diplomatic solution. In August 2005, Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, a hard-liner, was elected president of Iran. He accused Iranian negotiators who had negotiated the Paris Accords of treason over the next 2 months. The EU3 agreement fell apart as talks over the EU3's proposed long-term agreement broke down. The Iranian government felt that the proposal was heavy on demands, light on incentives, did not incorporate Iran's proposals, and violated the Paris Agreement. Iran notified the IAEA that it would resume uranium conversion at Isfahan. In February 2006, Iran ended its voluntary implementation of the additional protocol and resumed enrichment at Natanz, prompting the IAEA Board of Governors to refer Iran to the UN Security Council after the vote. Iran announced it would resume enrichment of uranium in April 2006. Ahmadinejad announced that Iran had nuclear technology, but stated that it was purely for power generation and not for producing weapons in June 2006. The EU3 joined China, Russia, and the United States to form the P5-1 the following month. July 2006, the UN Security Council passed its first resolution demanding Iran stop uranium enrichment and processing altogether. From 2006 to 2010, the UN Security Council subsequently adopted 6 resolutions concerning Iran's nuclear program: 1696 July 2006, 1737 December 2006, 1747 March 2007, 1803 March 2008, 1835 September 2008, and 1929 June 2010. The legal authority for the IAEA Board of Governors referral and the Security Council resolutions was derived from the IAEA statute and the United Nations Charter. The resolutions demanded that Iran cease enrichment activities and imposed sanctions on Iran, including bans on the transfer of nuclear and missile technology to the country and freezes on the assets of certain Iranian individuals and entities, in order to pressure the country. However, in Resolution 1803 and elsewhere, the Security Council also acknowledged Iran's rights under Article 4 of the NPT, which provides for the inalienable right to develop research, production and use of nuclear energy for peaceful purposes. In July 2006, Iran opened the Arak heavy water production plant, which led to one of the Security Council resolutions in September 2009. U.S. President Barack Obama revealed the existence of an underground enrichment facility in Fordow, near Qom, saying that Iran's decision to build yet another nuclear facility without notifying the IAEA represents a direct challenge to the basic compact at the center of the non-proliferation regime. Israel threatened to take military action against Iran in a February 2007 interview with the Financial Times. IAEA Director General Mohammad El-Baradei said that military action against Iran would be catastrophic, counterproductive, and called for negotiations between the international community and Iran over the Iranian nuclear program. El-Baradei specifically proposed a double, simultaneous suspension, a timeout, as a confidence-building measure, under which the international sanctions would be suspended and Iran would suspend enrichment. El-Baradei also said that, if I look at it from a weapons perspective, there are much more important issues to me than the suspension of, naming his top priorities as preventing Iran from go to industrial capacity until the issues are settled, building confidence, with full inspection involving Iranian adoption of the additional protocol, and, at all costs, preventing Iran from moving out of the system. A November 2007 U.S. National Intelligence estimate assessed that Iran halted its nuclear weapons program in 2003. That estimate and subsequent U.S. intelligence community statements also assessed that the Iranian government at the time had was keeping open the option to develop nuclear weapons in the future. A July 2015 Congressional Research Service report said that statements from the U.S. intelligence community indicate that Iran has the technological and industrial capacity to produce nuclear weapons at some point, but the U.S. government assesses that Tehran has not mastered all of the necessary technologies for building a nuclear weapon. In March 2013, the United States began a series of secret bilateral talks with Iranian officials in Oman, led by William Joseph Burns and Jake Sullivan on the American side and Ali Asghar Qaji on the Iranian side in June 2013. Hassan Rouhani was elected president of Iran. Rouhani has been described as more moderate, pragmatic, and willing to negotiate than Ahmadinejad. However, in a 2006 nuclear negotiation with European powers, Rouhani said that Iran had used the negotiations to dupe the Europeans, saying that during the negotiations, Iran managed to master the conversion of uranium yellowcake at Isfahan. The conversion of yellowcake is an important step in the nuclear fuel process. In August 2013, 3 days after his inauguration, Rouhani called for a resumption of serious negotiations with the P5-1 on the Iranian nuclear program. In September 2013, Obama and Rouhani had a telephone conversation, the first high-level contact between U.S. and Iranian leaders since 1979, and U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry had a meeting with Iranian Foreign Minister Mohammad Javad Zarif, signaling that the two countries had an opening to cooperation after several rounds of negotiations. On 24 November 2013, the Joint Plan of Action, an interim agreement on the Iranian nuclear program, was signed between Iran and the P5-1 countries in Geneva, Switzerland. It consisted of a short-term freeze of portions of Iran's nuclear program in exchange for decreased economic sanctions on Iran. As the countries work towards a long-term agreement, the IAEA began more intrusive and frequent inspections. Under this interim agreement, the agreement was formally activated on 20 January 2014. On that day, the IAEA issued a report stating that Iran was adhering to the terms of the interim agreement, including stopping enrichment of uranium to 20%, beginning the dilution process to reduce half of the stockpile of 20% enriched uranium to 35%, and halting work on the Iraq heavy water reactor. A major focus on the negotiations was limitations on Iran's key nuclear facilities, the Iraq IR-40 heavy water reactor and production plant, which was under construction, but never became operational, as Iran agreed as part of the November 2013 Joint Plan of Action Interim Agreement not to commission or fuel the reactor, the Bushehr nuclear power plant, the Gachin uranium mine, the Fordow fuel enrichment plant, the Isfahan uranium conversion plant, the Natanz uranium enrichment plant, and the Parchin military research and development complex. Negotiations main article, negotiations leading to the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. The agreement between the P5-1 EU and Iran on the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action JCPOA is the culmination of 20 months of arduous negotiations. The agreement followed the Joint Plan of Action JPA, an interim agreement between the P5-1 powers and Iran that was agreed to on 24 November 2013 at Geneva. The Geneva Agreement was an interim deal, in which Iran agreed to roll back parts of its nuclear program in exchange for relief from some sanctions. This went into effect on 20 January 2014. The parties agreed to extend their talks with a first extension deadline on 24 November 2014 and a second extension deadline set to 1 July 2015. An Iran nuclear deal framework was reached on 2 April 2015. Under this framework, Iran agreed tentatively to accept restrictions on its nuclear program, all of which would last for at least a decade and some longer, and to submit to an increased intensity of international inspections under a framework deal. These details were to be negotiated by the end of June 2015. The negotiations toward a Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action were extended several times until the final agreement. The Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action was finally reached on 14 July 2015. The JCPOA is based on the framework agreement from 3 months earlier. Subsequently, the negotiations between Iran and the P5-1 continued in April 2014. A framework deal was reached at Lausanne. Intense marathon negotiations then continued, with the last session in Vienna at the Palais Coburg lasting for 17 days. At several points, negotiations appeared to be at risk of breaking down, but negotiators managed to come to agreement as the negotiators neared a deal. U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry directly asked Iranian Foreign Minister Mohammad Javad Zarif to confirm that he was authorized to actually make a deal, not just by the president, but by the supreme leader. Zarif gave assurances that he was ultimately. On 14 July 2015, all parties agreed to a landmark comprehensive nuclear agreement at the time of the announcement, shortly before 11 o'clock Greenwich Mean Time. The agreement was released to the public. The final agreement's complexity shows the impact of a public letter written by a bipartisan group of 19 U.S. diplomats, experts, and others in June 2015, written when negotiations were still going on, that letter outlined concerns about the several provisions in the then unfinished agreement and called for a number of improvements to strengthen the prospective agreement and win their support for it after the final agreement was reached. One of the signatories, Robert J. Einhorn, a former U.S. Department of State official now at the Brookings Institution, said of the agreement, "Analysts will be pleasantly surprised the more things are agreed to, the less opportunity there is for implementation difficulties later on. The final agreement is based upon and buttresses the rules-based nonproliferation regime created by the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty NPT and including especially the IAEA safeguard system." Souvenir signatures of lead negotiators on the cover page of the JCPOA document. The Persian handwriting on top left side is a homage by Javad Zarif to his counterpart's efforts in the negotiations, sincere to Mr. Abbas and Mr. Majid. Signatories: China Wang Yi, Foreign Minister France Laurent Fabius, Foreign Minister Germany Frank-Walter Steinmeier, Minister of Foreign Affairs European Union Federica Mogherini, High Representative Iran Mohammad Javad Zarif, Minister of Foreign Affairs Russia Sergei Lavrov, Foreign Minister United Kingdom Philip Hammond, Foreign Secretary United States John Kerry, Secretary of State. Summary of provisions: the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action JCPOA runs to 109 pages, including 5 annexes. Major provisions of the final accord include the following: Nuclear JCPOA Summary of Enrichment-Related Provision Sources, The Economist Belfer Center, 29 Capability before JCPOA after JCPOA for 10-year period after 15 years first generation. Centrifuges installed 19,138 capped at 6,104 unconstrained advanced centrifuges installed 1,080 unconstrained centrifuge R. Medium enriched uranium 196. And where Iran may have enrichment facilities according to Belfer, at this point Iran could expand its nuclear program to create more practical overt and covert nuclear weapons options. For 10 years, Iran will place over two-thirds of its centrifuges in storage, from its current stockpile of 19,000 centrifuges of which 10,000 were operational to no more than 6,104 operational centrifuges, with only 5,060 allowed to enrich uranium, with the enrichment capacity being limited to the Natanz plant. The centrifuges: there must be IR-1 centrifuges, the first-generation centrifuge type which is Iran's oldest and least efficient. Iran will give up its advanced IR-2M centrifuges in this period. The non-operating centrifuges will be stored in Natanz and monitored by IAEA, but may be used to replace failed centrifuges. Iran will not build any new uranium enrichment facilities for 15 years. Iran may continue research and development work on enrichment, but that work will take place only at the Natanz facility and include certain limitations for the first 8 years. This is intended to keep the country to a breakout time of 1 year. Iran, with cooperation from the working group, the P5-1 and possibly other countries, will modernize and rebuild the Iraq heavy water research reactor based on an agreed design to support its peaceful nuclear research and production needs and purposes, but in such a way to minimize the production of plutonium and not to produce weapons-grade plutonium. The power of the redesigned reactor will not exceed 20 MWTH. The P5-1 parties will support and facilitate the timely and safe construction of the Iraq complex. All spent fuel will be sent out of the country. All excess heavy water which is beyond Iran's needs for the redesigned reactor will be made available for export to the international market based on international prices for 15 years. Iran will not engage in, or research on, spent fuel reprocessing. Iran will also not build any additional heavy water reactors or accumulate heavy water for 15 years. Iran's Fordow facility will stop enriching uranium and researching uranium enrichment for at least 15 years. The facility will be converted into a nuclear physics and technology center for 15 years. Fordow will maintain no more than 1,044 IR-1 centrifuges in 6 cascades in one wing of Fordow. 2 of those 6 cascades will spin without uranium and will be transitioned, including through appropriate infrastructure modification, for stable radioisotope production for medical, agricultural, industrial, and scientific use. The other 4 cascades with all associated infrastructure will remain idle. Iran will not be permitted to have any fissile material in Fordow. Iran will implement an additional protocol agreement which will continue in perpetuity for as long as Iran remains a party to the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty NPT. The signing of the additional protocol represents a continuation of the monitoring and verification provisions long after the comprehensive agreement between the P5-1 and Iran is implemented. A comprehensive inspections regime will be implemented in order to monitor and confirm that Iran is complying with its obligations and is not diverting any fissile material. The IAEA will have multilayered oversight over Iran's entire nuclear supply chain, from uranium mills to its procurement of nuclear-related technologies. For declared nuclear sites such as Fordow and Natanz, the IAEA will have round-the-clock access to nuclear facilities and will be entitled to maintain continuous monitoring, including via surveillance equipment at such sites. The agreement authorizes the IAEA to make use of sophisticated monitoring technology, such as fiber-optic seals on equipment that can electronically send information to the IAEA, infrared satellite imagery to detect covert sites, environmental sensors that can detect minute signs of nuclear particles, tamper-resistant, radiation-resistant cameras. Other tools include computerized accounting programs to gather information and detect anomalies, and big data sets on Iranian imports to monitor dual-use items. The number of IAEA inspectors assigned to Iran will triple, from 50 to 150 inspectors, if IAEA inspectors have concerns that Iran is developing nuclear capabilities at any non-declared sites. They may request access to verify the absence of undeclared nuclear materials and activities or activities inconsistent with the agreement, informing Iran of the basis for their concerns. The inspectors would only come from countries with which Iran has diplomatic relations. Iran may admit the inspectors to such site or propose alternatives to inspection that might satisfy the IAEA's concerns if such an agreement cannot be reached. A process running to a maximum of 24 days is triggered under this process. Iran and the IAEA have 14 days to resolve disagreements among themselves. If they fail to, the Joint Commission, including all eight parties, would have 1 week in which to consider the intelligence which initiated the IAEA request. A majority of the commission, at least 5 of the 8 members, could then inform Iran of the action that it would be required to take within 3 more days. The majority rule provision means the United States and its European allies, Britain, France, Germany and the EU, could insist on access or any other steps, and that Iran, Russia or China could not veto them. If Iran did not comply with the decision within 3 days, sanctions would be automatically reimposed under the snapback provision. See below. As a result of the above, the breakout time, the time in which it would be possible for Iran to make enough material for a single nuclear weapon, will increase from 2 to 3 months to 1 year, according to U.S. officials and U.S. intelligence. An August 2015 report published by a group of experts at Harvard University's Belfer Center for Science and International Affairs concurs in these estimates, writing that under the JCPOA, over the next decade would be extended to roughly a year, from the current estimated breakout time of 2 to 3 months. The Center for Arms Control and Non-Proliferation also accepts these estimates. By contrast, Alan J. Cooperman, coordinator of the Nuclear Proliferation Prevention Project at the University of Texas at Austin, disputed the one-year assessment, arguing that under the agreement, Iran's breakout time would be only about 3 months, not much longer than it is today. The longer breakout time would be in place for at least 10 years. After that point, the breakout time would gradually decrease by the 15th year. U.S. officials state that the breakout time would return to the pre-JCPOA status quo of a few months. The Belfer Center report states, some contributors to this report believe that breakout time by year 15 could be comparable to what it is today, a few months, while others believe it could be reduced to a few weeks. Sanctions. Further information, sanctions against Iran. The following provisions regarding sanctions are written into the JCPOA. Following the issuance of a IAEA report verifying implementation by Iran of the nuclear-related measures, the UN sanctions against Iran and some EU sanctions will terminate and some will be suspended. Once sanctions are lifted, Iran will recover approximately $100 billion of its assets. U.S. Treasury Department estimate frozen in overseas banks 8 years into the agreement. EU sanctions against a number of Iranian companies, individuals and institutions such as the Revolutionary Guards will be lifted. The United States will cease application of its nuclear-related secondary sanctions by presidential action or executive waiver. Secondary sanctions are those that sanction other countries for doing business with Iran. Primary U.S. sanctions, which prohibit U.S. firms from conducting commercial transactions with with few exceptions, are not altered by the JCPOA. This step is not tied to any specific date, but is expected to occur roughly in the first half of 2016. Sanctions relating to ballistic missile technologies would remain for 8 years. Similar sanctions on conventional weapon sales to Iran would remain for 5 years. However, all U.S. sanctions against Iran related to alleged human rights abuses, missiles, and support for terrorism are not affected by the agreement and will remain in place. U.S. sanctions are viewed as more stringent, since many have extraterritorial effect, i.e., they apply worldwide. EU sanctions, by contrast, apply only in Europe. No new UN or EU nuclear-related sanctions or restrictive measures will be imposed if Iran violates the agreement. Any of the P51 can invoke a snap-back provision, under which the sanctions snap back into place, i.e., are re-implemented. Specifically, the JCPOA establishes the following dispute resolution process. If a party to the JCPOA has reason to believe that another party is not upholding its commitments under the agreement, then the complaining party may refer its complaint to the Joint Commission, a body created under the JCPOA to monitor implementation. If a complaint made by a non-Iran party is not resolved to the satisfaction of the complaining party within 35 days of referral, then that party could treat the unresolved issue as grounds to cease performing its commitments under the JCPOA, notify the United Nations Security Council that it believes the issue constitutes significant non-performance, or both. The Security Council would then have 30 days to adopt a resolution to continue the lifting of sanctions. If such a resolution is not adopted within those 30 days, then the sanctions of all of the pre-JCPOA nuclear-related UN Security Council resolutions would automatically be re-imposed. Iran has stated that in such a case, it would cease performing its nuclear obligations under the deal. The effect of this rule is that any permanent member of the Security Council, United States, United Kingdom, China, Russia, and France, can veto any ongoing sanctions relief, but no member can veto the re-imposition of sanctions. Snapback sanctions would not apply with retroactive effect to contracts signed between any party and Iran or Iranian individuals and entities prior to the date of application, provided that the activities contemplated under and execution of such contracts are consistent with this JCPOA and the previous and current UN Security Council resolutions. Ankit Panda of The Diplomat states that this will make impossible any scenario where Iran is non-compliant with the JCPOA yet escapes re-imposition of sanctions. Mark Dubowitz of the Foundation for Defense of Democracies, which opposes the agreement, argues, however, that because the JCPOA provides that Iran could treat reinstatement of sanctions in part or entirely as grounds for leaving the agreement, the United States would be reluctant to impose a snapback for smaller violations. The only thing you'll take to the Security Council are massive Iranian violations, because you're certainly not going to risk the Iranians walking away from the deal and engaging in nuclear escalation over smaller violations. Records. According to several commentators, JCPOA is the first of its kind in the annals of non-proliferation and is in many aspects unique. The 159-page JCPOA document and its five appendices is the most spacious text of a multinational treaty since World War II. Throughout the history of international law, this is the first and only time that a country subject to Chapter 7 of the United Nations Charter, Iran, has managed to end its case and stop being subject to this chapter through diplomacy. All other cases have ended through either regime change, war, or full implementation of the Security Council's decisions by the country. This is the first time that the United Nations Security Council has recognized the nuclear enrichment program of a developing country, Iran, and backs an agreement JCPOA signed by several countries within the framework of a resolution, United Nations Security Council Resolution 2231. For the first time in the history of the United Nations, a country, Iran, was able to abolish six UN resolutions against it: -1696, 1737, 1747, 1803, 1835, 1929, without even one day of implementing them. Sanctions against Iran was also lifted for the first time in the 47-year history of the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, NPT. No country other than Iran has ever voluntarily agreed to put extraordinary restrictions on its nuclear activities during the final negotiations. U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry stayed in Vienna for 17 days, making him the top American official devoting time to a single international negotiation. negotiation in more than four decades, Mohammad Javad Zarif broke the record of an Iranian foreign minister being far from home with 18 days' stay in Vienna, and set the record of 106 days of negotiations in 687 days, a number higher than any other chief nuclear negotiator in 12 years. The negotiations became the longest continuous negotiations with the presence of all foreign ministers of the permanent members of the United Nations Security Council pictured here, Iranian Foreign Affairs Minister and U.S. Secretary of State shaking hands at the end of negotiations on 14 July 2015, Vienna. They shook hands on 26 September 2013 in the United Nations headquarters for the first time. The negotiations included rare events in Iran-United States relations not only since the 1979 Iranian Revolution, but also in the history of the bilateral relations. The U.S. Secretary of State and Iranian Foreign Minister met on 18 different dates, sometimes multiple occasions a day and in 11 different cities, unprecedented since the beginning of the relations on 27 April 2015, John Kerry visited the official residence of the permanent representative of Iran to the United Nations, which counts as Iranian soil, to meet his counterpart. The encounter was the first of its kind since the Iran hostage crisis on the sidelines of the 70th session of the United Nations General Assembly. U.S. President Barack Obama shook hands with the Iranian Foreign Minister Javad Zarif, marking the first such event in history. The event was also noted in form of diplomatic ranks, as a head of state shook hands with a minister. Obama is reported to have said in the meeting, "Too much effort has been put into the JCPOA and we all should be diligent to implement it." Reactions, political and diplomatic reactions. There was a significant worldwide response following the announcement of the agreement. More than 90 countries endorsed the agreement, as did many international organizations from countries that are parties to the JCPOA. President Hassan Rouhani said the final agreement proved that constructive engagement works and presented the deal as a step on the road towards a wider goal of international cooperation. With this unnecessary crisis resolved, new horizons emerge with a focus on shared challenges. Minister of Foreign Affairs Mohammad Javad Zarif called it an historic moment and said, "Today could have been the end of hope on this issue, but now we are starting a new chapter of hope. Let's build on that." In a 21 July speech to the Iranian parliament, Zarif said that the agreement was a defeat for Israel, saying that never before was the Zionist regime so isolated, even among her own allies. On 12 August, after a meeting with Hezbollah leader Hassan Nasrallah, Zarif said that the agreement created a historic opportunity to for regional cooperation to fight extremism and face threats posed by the Zionist entity. Many Iranian families and youth celebrated at Vanak Square and elsewhere on the streets of Tehran on the evening of the agreement's announcements. Some held signs calling for the release of Iranian opposition leaders Mir Hussein Mousavi and Mehdi Kherouabi from house arrest. Other ordinary Iranians cheered the announcement on social media on 16 July 2015, 2 days after the agreement was signed. Iran's supreme leader, Ayatollah Ali Khamenei, made his first public comments on the final agreement in a letter to President Hassan Rouhani posted on Khamenei's website. Khamenei wrote that bringing the negotiations to a conclusion was a milestone, but that the prepared text, however, needs careful scrutiny. Iranian hardliners took the letter as a signal of openness to criticize the deal in a speech in Tehran marking the end of Ramadan made 2 days later. Khamenei said, "Our policies toward the arrogant government of the United States will not be changed at all," adding that the Americans say they stopped Iran from acquiring a nuclear weapon. "They know it's not true. We had a fatwa declaring nuclear weapons to be religiously forbidden under Islamic law. It had nothing to do with the nuclear talks." However, Khamenei also praised the negotiators who arranged the deal, which was taken as a symbol that he would not seek to block the deal in the Iranian parliament or the Supreme National Security Council. Khamenei also expressed support for the agreement, saying, "After 12 years of struggling with the Islamic Republic, the result is that they have to bear the turning of thousands of centrifuges in the country." Khamenei is believed to have approved the negotiations and the agreement, giving Rouhani crucial political cover to do so. The New York Times reported that Iran's influential hardliners, who have criticized Mr. Rouhani in much the same way that President Obama has been denounced by Republicans in the United States, signaled their intent to undercut the agreement, which they believe to be too favorable to the West. Fohd Azadi, a professor at the University of Tehran, complained that Of the 19 Iranian major red lines identified by the Supreme Leader during negotiations, 18 and a half have been crossed, conservative lawmaker Alireza Zakani said. Celebrating too early can send a bad signal to the enemy. Iran's official Islamic Republic news agency stressed that under the agreement, world powers have recognized Iran's peaceful nuclear program and are to respect the nuclear rights of Iran within international conventions. The IRNA report also said that the policy on preventing enrichment uranium is now failed and stressed that no Iranian nuclear facilities or centrifuges will be dismantled. Saying in the House of Commons that no agreement with Iran would have been enough for Netanyahu and that Israel prefers a permanent state of standoff with Iran at a joint press conference the next day in Jerusalem, Hammond and Netanyahu sparred publicly over the agreement, veering off prepared comments in an awkward back and forth that extended what is usually a standard, brief public appearance with visiting officials into a spirited debate. This is not the time for politics or posturing. Tough talk from Washington does not solve problems. Hard-nosed diplomacy, leadership that has united the world's major powers, offers a more effective way to verify that Iran is not pursuing a nuclear weapon. At a press briefing in Vienna, Secretary of State John Kerry said that the agreement was a measurable step away from the prospect of nuclear proliferation and the specter of conflict, and that there can be no question that this agreement will provide a stronger, more comprehensive, and more lasting means of limiting Iran's nuclear program than any realistic alternative. Kerry also stated that the deal we have reached gives us the greatest assurance that we have had that Iran will not pursue a weapon covertly. Addressing critics of the agreement, Kerry stated that those who spend a lot of time suggesting that something could be better have an obligation to provide an alternative that, in fact, works, and that sanctioning Iran until it capitulates makes for a powerful talking point and a pretty good political speech, but it's not achievable outside a world of fantasy. Kerry also stated that we are under no illusions that the hard work is over. No one is standing here today to say that the path ahead is easy or automatic. We move now to a new phase. Dangerous, deeply flawed, and short-sighted. While Lindsey Graham asserted that the deal was a death sentence for the state of Israel, former Obama adviser Daniel Pfeiffer tweeted that none of these GOP contenders would end this Iran deal if they got to the White House, and that it would massively damage U.S. in the world. Candidates for the Democratic nomination for president in 2016 welcomed the deal. Former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton called the agreement an important step that puts the lid on Iran's nuclear programs. Senator Bernie Sanders called it a victory for diplomacy over saber-rattling that could keep the United States from being drawn into another never-ending war in the Middle East. Speaker of the House John Boehner, a Republican, called the JCPOA a bad deal. House Minority Leader Nancy Pelosi, a Democrat, said, "I've closely examined this document and it will have my strong support." Pelosi said that the agreement was the product of years of tough, bold, clear-eyed leadership on the part of President Obama and called it a strong, effective option for keeping the peace and stopping the proliferation of weapons of mass destruction. Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell, a Republican, opposed the agreement, saying, "The comprehensive nuclear agreement announced today appears to further the flawed elements of April's interim agreement because the Obama administration approached these talks from a flawed perspective, reaching the best deal acceptable to Iran, rather than actually advancing our national goal of ending Iran's nuclear program." Senate Minority Leader Harry Reid, a Democrat, issued a brief statement on 14 July saying that the agreement was the result of years of hard work and that now it is incumbent on Congress to review this agreement with the thoughtful, level-headed process an agreement of this magnitude deserves. On 23 August, Reid endorsed the agreement, saying that the agreement is the best path to stop Iran from obtaining a nuclear weapon and that he would do everything in my power to ensure that it stands. Senate Armed Services Committee Chairman John McCain, a Republican, pledged to hold hearings on the deal during the 60-day congressional review period and said that he is totally opposed to the agreement. Senate Foreign Relations Committee Chairman Bob Corker, another Republican, also opposed the deal, saying that he believed that the West had conceded too much. The New York Times editorial board wrote that the agreement is potentially one of the most consequential accords in recent diplomatic history, with the ability not just to keep Iran from obtaining a nuclear weapon but also to reshape Middle East politics. They wrote, "It would be irresponsible to squander this chance to rein in Iran's nuclear program." From other countries. Party, called the agreement Israel's biggest foreign policy failure since the establishment of the state. At the same time, many of these figures also criticized Netanyahu's diplomatic campaign against the plan, calling it ineffectual and counter-productive. Yakimovich said that Netanyahu should immediately cease and desist from confronting the Americans. Lapid called on the prime minister to resign, stating, "I also am not thrilled by Obama's policies, but Netanyahu crossed a line that caused the White House to stop listening to Israel. In the last year we weren't even in the arena, we had no representative in Vienna, our intelligence cooperation was harmed, and the door to the White House was closed to us." The head of the opposition Yisrael Beitenu party, Avigdor Lieberman, described the agreement as a surrender to terror. Zeava Gal-On, head of the opposition Meretz party, voiced cautious support for the JCPOA, writing, "The agreement is not perfect, it does not turn Iran into lovers of Israel all of the sudden, but it does aim to prevent Iran from obtaining a bomb, regulate the international mechanisms to monitoring it, and allows the international community to act if the agreement is violated." The Joint Arab List Party of Arab Israeli MKs welcomed the agreement. Ami Ayalon, former head of the Israeli Internal Security Service Shin Bet and former commander of the Israeli Navy, said that the agreement was the best option for Israel, saying that when negotiations began, Iran was 2 months away from acquiring enough material for a bomb, now it will be 12 months. Ayalon said that opposition to the deal in Israel was more emotional than logical. Ephraim Halevi, the director of the Israeli intelligence agency Mossad from 1998 to 2002, wrote in support of the agreement in Yediath Aharonot, arguing that the JCPOA includes components that are crucial for Israel's security and warning that a collapse of the agreement will leave Iran free to do as it pleases. Chuck Freilich, a former deputy national security advisor in Israel and current senior fellow at Harvard University's Belfer Center, wrote an op-ed for the New York Times arguing that the JCPOA is a good deal for Israel and that by avoiding the threat of a nuclear Iran, the agreement will enable Israel to divert precious resources to more immediate threats and to pressing domestic needs.